I would like to take prayer requests from children, but I need a pen so that I can remember them. So, if there are any prayer requests just from the children this morning? Yes, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. It's time for the children to come forward.
Thank you.
count the things in the front and you guys count the things in the front. West end, back end, back end. Four. Three. Okay, put them back in.
Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 through 6, and verses 9 through 11. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work and you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless by the day of Christ. Filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes from Jesus Christ, to glory and praise of God.
Please pray with me. Lord God, we're so thankful and grateful for the presence of your Spirit with us that helps us to hear these words, interpret them, and apply them into our lives. God, we ask that you would open our hearts and minds to receive your word, that you would help me to speak and to think clearly. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. So it is Graduate Sunday, the day that we honor our folks who are graduating this year from high school. A wonderful joy. It has been a lofty weekend. We've heard commencement addresses that we can remember back to hearing about them when people talk about what amazing accomplishments the kids have done all the way through school, and then cast vision and hopes and dreams for what is in the future for them. One of the things I feel like people always do is read from Dr. Seuss's, "Oh, the places you'll go." Did you happen to hear that at this graduation? Yeah, okay, at least Jan did, right? When Dr. Seuss, in wonderful rhyme, talks about all the adventures and opportunities that the world affords you, and just casts amazing vision for what is possible, because you're standing on the threshold of adult life, and what will you be, and will you change the world? And certainly, you might think, graduates, you might have thought about this, you know, when I come back in 20 years or in 30 years from my reunion, are there going to be people who actually have changed the world, who've really done spectacular things? And which people are they going to be? And could it be me? Am I going to be one of those folks? And so people give you blessings, and they give you compliments and praise and best wishes and hopes, and it's wonderful, right? Might be maybe a little intimidating, maybe. In scripture, we don't read from Dr. Seuss, but we read from Dr. Paul, who wrote Philippians. Not you, Dr. Paul, the other Dr. Paul, the Apostle Paul. And Paul says, "In my prayers, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Jesus Christ." God, who made you, is going to do wonderful things with you through Jesus Christ. Again, a huge, lofty, awesome goal. But maybe a little bit of pressure. Now for the graduates, and for all of us, I can't say what is going to be in the future, what wonderful thing you are going to accomplish. But there's one thing that I know for certain that you will experience when you're out there in the world, and that is failure. That is disappointment. With all those lofty goals and those big dreams that you are going to shoot for, if you're like all the rest of us adults in the room, there's going to be something that disappoints you, something that does not go the way it's planned. So that's what I want to talk about today. I hope super things happen for you, but when you are disappointed and when you fail, I want you to keep this in mind. I'm going to tell you a story, read to you a story about Jesus and the disciples in a moment when the disciples failed, or one of the disciples failed. Immediately Jesus, this is in Matthew 14, made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went to a mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but the boat was already a considerable distance from the land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. During the fourth night watch, which is very late into the night, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I, don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come out to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and he began to sink and cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped Jesus, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The story of Peter's failure to walk on water. What do we know from the story? We know one thing. thing about Peter is that this guy is kind of impulsive, right? He's like a child who's a little impulsive, really. Like, yes, I would love to jump out and try to walk on the water. He saw this. He, along with the rest of the disciples, was so startled to see Jesus come across. It was frightening. It was something they had never seen before. And where most of the disciples kind of hang back and are like, whoa, I'm just going to sit here and kind of check things out for a little bit. Jesus said, or Peter says, if it's you, Jesus, tell me to walk out to you. He takes on that challenge. He sees a new thing and he sets a goal. I want to do it too, right? He's inspired. He's passionate. Tell me to come out to you. And he listens for Jesus to say, come, very important. Jesus said yes. And so he steps out. And he's looking at Jesus and he begins to walk across the surface of the water. And if you're like me, I sort of wonder, like, did his feet get a little wet? Were his ankles wet? Like, where was the water up to? I'm kind of, you know, like, I wonder about these things. Was it like a hard surface that he was walking on? I don't know. But he's walking across the water. He's looking at Jesus. And then maybe that strong wind that we hear about splashed a wave onto the side of the boat and the spray hit Jesus in the face. It hit Peter in the face. And all of a sudden he looks around and he sees the wind and it's pretty dark, so but he can tell that there's a heavy cloud cover and he can see the churning waves. And Peter, who his whole life has been surrounded by fishermen, knows that this is not a very safe place to be. His life now is really at risk. He is surrounded by choppy water. You probably can swim a little bit. Right? Probably a little bit. But in this kind of surf you want to get in? No. This is the time you want to be in the boat or on the shore. And yet he's out some distance now from the boat, getting closer to Jesus, but starting to feel himself sink. He has some very significant, very real, life-threatening challenges around him. And as he sinks, he cries out, Lord, save me. His focus now away from the waves and looking at Jesus. And as he looks at Jesus, Jesus' hand is already out to him. Immediately, it says, Matthew's favorite word. Immediately, Jesus' hand was right there. He grabs Jesus' hand, those strong fingers, the strong arm. And just at that moment, I believe that he looked right at Jesus' face, right into his eyes, grabbing hold of that hand. And there was a moment in time there where he looked right into Jesus' eyes, and he couldn't hear the wind, and he couldn't feel the spray from the waves. All he could see was peace. And Jesus' strong arm pulled him out of the water, and they went back to the boat. He put him in the boat, and the storm calmed. We're told this story as a historical fact. Hard for us rationalists, but let's take it as a fact. Written in the Bible. But what a beautiful metaphor for life. And our graduating seniors know, because of their many years in ELA, can interpret metaphors like this. And so I'd like to invite them forward to now interpret the metaphor. No? They're like, I wasn't, no one's ready to get out. Yes! Get out of the boat! No, you can do it. I'm just kidding. That's awesome. No, I'll interpret it for you. You're on great radio. But what a lovely thing. To think that you three who are here, but any of us, that when we see something new and challenging and weird and strange, and then we get excited and passionate about it, and we say, oh, I want to do that, that we would say, Lord, if it's you, tell me to step out of the boat. That we ask God, wow, this is exciting. Lord, what do you think? And we listen for that, come, that okay for God, right? We take that moment to ask the question, is this good? Okay, good. And that we would step out. We have some great dreams, some passion. Maybe when you're in school, it's a major. Maybe when you're in school, it's a person, right? This is the life partner that you're meeting. Whatever it is, and you're like, it's a new job at the end of graduation for adults, a new project, whatever it is. And we say, I'm going to go for that thing. I'm going to do it. I think I heard God say yes, say come. And so you're going to step out, and maybe you will experience some moments of success there. And it feels so good. You're like, and then all of a sudden, the slap of the spray in your face. There's a discouragement. Somebody doesn't agree with you. Someone stands against you. The money goes away. The grades come in very low. The scholarship disappears. The relationship is so troubled. And you start to look around at the things that are very real and significant challenges to you. This could sink your boat, right? These are things that could destroy you and destroy the life that you love. And just because Jesus is right there doesn't mean the challenges aren't very real to you. They are significant. You begin to sink. And at that moment, thank God for the times that we sink. Thank God for the times that we feel ourselves sinking, because it reminds ourselves, again, call out, God, help me. Save me. I can't do this on my own. On my own, I'm in the water. On my own, I'm overwhelmed. I'm overcome. I cannot do it. And so we say, God, save me. We reach out our hand, and God's hand is already there. Already there. To grab hold. And we have that moment where we look at God in the face, and we are so thankful we are no longer looking at the waves and the wind and the clouds, no longer thinking about how far away the boat is and how far away worldly safety is for us. And we're just looking at the face of God. And we have that moment of peace where those fears are just miraculously gone, because we are just looking at God. How do we do that? Practice. This is something you develop and nurture as an adult, and we as adults are still perfecting and practicing. How do we look at the face of God? But we spend time in prayer, just talk to God, just like I'm talking to you now. Some people say, I have a hard time praying. I feel funny praying. Please just talk. Please just say what's on your mind. God already actually knows what you're going to pray, so you might as well just pray it, right? Just say it. And say, you can even say these words, God, show me your face. That's tradition, that's in the Bible. Show me your face, God. What is going on here? Help me, and save me. You spend time in prayer, maybe you open your Bible, right? You might look at some gospel stories and remind yourself of who Jesus is. You might get yourself in church or in a community of believers where people can offer you hope and wisdom. That's how you look at the face of God. That's how you find that peace. And all the things that threaten you fade. That will bring you back into the boat. That will get you to safety after you have experienced a failure. That is a healthy response to failure. When you are in school, and Ethan can probably attest to this, because he's a college student, you are going to see kids, your colleagues, your cohort, deal with stress and disappointment and failure in a whole lot of ways. And adults see this too. There's a lot of ways to sort of blunt yourself to the disappointments of life. You're going to see people use a lot of alcohol. You're going to see them use promiscuity. You're going to see them sleep in. They're going to see them avoid class. There's all sorts of ways you can cope with that stress and that disappointment. But if you look at God and you look for God's face, God's going to give you a healthy and productive way to deal with that, and maybe even use it to teach you and redeem the situation and make you be better. Please let God help you do that. Now I want to ask you a question. What do you think the disciples thought about Peter? You know, there is Peter bringing wet up to here. We're going to say, I see Peter sinking very slowly, by the way, because everything that happens in the story happens while he's sinking, sort of much. So he's only wet up to here. He gets back in the boat. Jesus helps him in the boat. The storm is calm. And now the disciples are looking at Peter being like, dude. All right, that's Peter. You know, Peter always sort of shoots from the hip. He's always really fast, not thinking before he leaps and whatever. You're like, you know, he's kind of dumb. You probably shouldn't have done that, right? Idiot. Okay. What do you think Jesus thinks about what Peter did? I think that Jesus is really proud of him. He did. He tried it. Wow. And then when he was sinking, he didn't flail his arms and turn around and try to run back to the boat. He went right to God with that. I think Jesus is like, A+, man. Yeah, you doubted. You doubted. Okay. But boy, did you step out on faith. Good for you. And what about Peter? Now this could go either way, but I have an opinion. Peter could be like, well, that was dumb. Like, only God walks on water. I'm not going to do that, right? I got it. I have my place. He could be like that. But maybe Peter has learned such an important lesson about where God is when Peter is walking in faith. Maybe Peter has learned in a tangible way that God will save him when he is failing. Maybe that lesson is never going to be unlearned from him because he experienced it. He held on to Jesus' hand. And Peter now has confidence. Do you think he would do it again? I think he would do it again. I was saying this to Sam last night. I said, I think that Peter would have done it again. And Sam says, read your Bible. He does do it again. And I said, thank you. Let's look at John chapter 21. After Jesus has died, buried, raised, walking along among the disciples and appearing. You know how they never recognize him, right? So one time the disciples are not really for sure what they should be doing now that Jesus is gone. So they go back to work. They're out fishing overnight. Catch nothing. Lame. About to head in, but they see a figure on the shore, and they don't recognize that it's Jesus. And the figure says, hey, cast your net on the other side of the boat. And they're like, okay. Throw it over there. So many fish, they can't even haul it in. Just by putting their net on the other side. And then the light bulb goes off. This is a miracle. That must be Jesus. John says, that must be the Lord. And guess what Peter does? I got to read this to you. It's the Lord. As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, it is the Lord, he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and got into the water. Now, I'm going to ask you, do you put on clothes to go swimming? I mean, hopefully you put on your swimsuit. We don't need any of that. This is true. But you know what I'm saying? Do you put on your robe to get into the, you put wrap your towel around your shoulders and then get in the water? No, you're going to sink, right? It's going to get wet. It's too heavy. You can't swim. Why did he put on his outer garment? Except maybe he thought he was in the water. Isn't that awesome? It changed him to have that experience of failure and Jesus saving him. It changed what he thought he could do. He knew that Jesus would be there for him. As a sidebar, I don't think that he walked, I think that he swam in this. It actually doesn't say, no comments here from John about whether or not he walked or swam. But he did it again. That's awesome. So I don't know what you're going to do, graduates, adults. I don't know what you're going to do either. I don't know what I'm going to do. We're probably going to fail. We're probably going to be disappointed. But please, let's follow the example here. Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you. And listen, come, okay. And then step out. And know that when you're there, maybe it'll be awesome. Maybe you will shoot for the stars and hit them. Maybe it'll be fantastic. But if not, when you reach out your hand and when you cry out, God is there for you to grab a hold and gives you a way to respond to that failure that will redeem that situation, that will teach you and make you better and stronger and change. So God bless you with your failures. It's going to be awesome. You can't wait to go out and fail, am I right, guys? So glad for my preaching about it. Yeah. So this is how I want to conclude with these words from Paul, from Philippians. This is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and the praise of God. That's my prayer for you, graduates, and for all of us. So this time I'd like to invite our graduates to come forward. We'll hear a little bit from you and we will pray for you.
Southern New Hampshire University.
And what will you be studying?
The human history arts.
Baking and Pastry Arts. We've seen many awesome creations already, and I'm really fired up. Something in me needs cake, right? It might actually be 50 or something. It's a long time from now. Nice news. Yeah, anyway, start thinking now. Okay. Noah, what about you? Where are you going?
I'm going to Ohio Wesleyan University.
Ohio Wesleyan University. And what do you know what you're going to be studying?
Yes, I'll be studying both history and political science.
Now, there's a surprise. Noah will be studying history and political science. All right, awesome. Boston University, mom must be thrilled.
Yeah.
Oh, I think she's moving away though. But not too far, right? Okay, good. And do you know what you could study?
No.
Not yet, and that's okay. That's great, right? Are you going to just take a bunch of survey courses? Do you have any hints or anything? Okay. Good, because it's you. I didn't know either. All right, well, let's just have a word of prayer. Lord God, I ask your hand of blessing over these three and just ask that you would prosper every effort that they have, that you would just build up their courage, God, that they wouldn't have feelings of inadequacy or being overwhelmed or anything when they start school, but that they would meet good and healthy friends right away. God, we ask that their classes would be just stimulating to their minds and that they might say, yes, this is where I need to be, or they might say no. No, this isn't it. And that you would just help them to discern, God. Help give them that wisdom as they go through school. We ask, God, a blessing on their roommates, Lord, on the friendships that they will have, on the professors that will guide and instruct them. Lord, we ask a blessing on their parents who are helping to foot the bill for this. And we ask that you make financial provision for the families. We ask that they would be safe now that they're going off as adults in the world, that they would have great fun and awesome times, Lord, but that you would just protect them with all the freedoms that they have and help them to make really good and great decisions that honor you, Lord. And we ask, Lord, if it is all possible, that they may be the ones who hit the stars when they shoot for the stars, that you would bless their every effort and allow them to succeed. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right. We ask, God, that you would bless our graduates and that you would bless this offering which we give to you for your service in the world. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Closer, heart with me.
right, let's go up.
Meeting is next Sunday after worship. If you are planning on going on the trip, especially if you're not going to be here next week, talk to me. But otherwise, we can talk after church on Sunday and see who is on the team this year. Ask the questions we need to. If you have questions, you can just come to the meeting for information and make a decision then. The main mission trip is July 10th to July 17th, so just in about a month. We have an announcement from the breakfast crew.
Announcement for the breakfast crew.
That we've successfully held the last breakfast of the season, so you guys don't have to hear announcements except for this one. So, as you heard earlier, there was 115 people served yesterday, which is a big accomplishment. We raised about $700 in donations. We served 25 pounds of bacon. Yeah, you can't complain about that. 25 pounds of corned beef hash and 22 dozen eggs. For the overall season, roughly, we served about 13,000 people.
Not 13.
Sorry. 1,000. Every week you hear Rob stand up and make the announcements, and Rob is probably the big cook in the kitchen every week. We have the breakfast. But little be known is that there's one person that is here starting on Thursday night, going shopping, Friday night setting up, here bright and early at 5 a.m. on Saturday morning before everybody else gets up. I'd like to actually personally thank him because it means a lot to see what he does. But I think he should be invited up and everybody thank him. So Kevin, come on down. But we have a little special music as we make your mark. Jabs and somebody came in and made a comment and it was known as being hot stuff. And I don't think it's because you poop, but Kevin,
I deserve it.
You do amazing. You absolutely do an amazing job for the community. I mean, as you heard, the numbers are up there and stuff, but you do more than anybody for the breakfast, and I'd like to thank you, and I'd ask for sure.
Until we meet again, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen.